On today's show, we're breaking down the AFC West. A lot of very fantasy-relevant players in this division. Where are we going to be drafting those Kansas City Chiefs? And we're talking about a bunch of news. DeAndre Hopkins, Evan Engram, and more. Make sure you subscribe to this channel. Leave us a comment about your favorite AFC West team, and enjoy.
In the city of angels, something monstrous lurks beyond the offseason.
I can't believe summer's almost over.
Man, this is going to be the best NFL season ever. I'm going to live forever.
This summer.
What?
Brace yourselves for an event of epic proportions. Something so colossal, so unthinkable, it will take your breath away.
Welcome in.
The Megala Show. Don't miss it. Welcome to the Fantasy Footballers Podcast with your hosts, Andy Holloway, Jason Moore, and Mike Wright.
Oh, welcome in. That was a different frequency. Different pitch. You
okay.
Excited?
I mean, yeah, no, we're good.
It's higher than normal.
I didn't notice. Well, I thought I was farther away from the microphone.
We're getting pretty close here, boys, to football being real.
Does that mean that my pitch will continue to increase?
Yes, so as we get closer and closer.
It's like puberty or something?
It's just going to go higher and higher.
Reverse.
Eventually, right, this will be a helium situation.
Okay. Welcome into the show, Tuesday, July 18th, the Fantasy Footballers. Excited to be back with you. And we are diving back into the divisional breakdowns, a very exciting AFC West edition today. We also have big news to talk about. We are recording this episode almost in conjunction with the Monday franchise player deadline. And so if breaking news happens...
I've got my ear to the ground.
His ear's on the literal ground.
Yes.
And if Saquon... or Jacobs were to reach an agreement.
If I get any vibrations.
You'll let us know.
I will. I'll jump
now,
in here.
If you're,
I'm going to let you know right now that you're not going to get any vibrations, Mike.
No vibrations.
No.
No
good vibrations. Well, this will only be sad news for running backs. The running backs will be playing on franchise tags. And Evan Engram. Yeah,
we'll get there.
A little early here.
We do have some big news. We'd like to invite everybody out there to the one and only live event for the Fantasy Footballers this year. I think we need mouth trumpets. Thank you.
Well done.
The Megala Show. It's just disturbing at this point. I don't know what it is. But I don't think of a shark. We are live in Los Angeles, August 26th. You can learn more about how you can come join us, ballerslive.com, get tickets, presented by Underdog Fantasy. But this is, you know, we've been doing live events since 2019?
I think maybe 18.
18, 19. When
I
was the
know.
When was the big tour, Brooksy?
One of those.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. It blends together, but this is the first time we've been at a venue this large. It'll be 1,000 seats at the Palace in LA. It will be right before the season begins. We have a lot planned, so we would love to have you join us. It is always a great time in person with the Foot Clan, our one and only, ballerslive.com. So hopefully you can make it out. You can find us and more information about the Megala Show and everything we're doing here on Twitter at the FF Ballers. The communities at jointhefoot.com, the website's thefantasyfootballers.com. Let's get into that news.
News and notes from around the league.
Well, DeAndre Hopkins has signed a two-year, $26 million contract with Ryan Tannehill and the Tennessee Titans. He turned 31 years old in June, and we've got him ranked. He's in the, he's on the website in our rankings, and he's on the ultimate draft kit. I think there was simultaneous, like, okay, we got some news on Hopkins.
Mm-hmm.
He can still play. I mean, great player. But a lot of excitement for Treylon Burks and Chigakonkwo, and both of those balloons, a little bit of air was let out of each of them.
Certainly.
Yeah, I mean, the excitement was twofold, right? Primarily, the excitement was they get the whole pie to themselves. Treylon Burks and Chigakonkwo were the two most talented receiving options for the Titans, and that's gone now. They are not the best. Like, Treylon Burks and Chig, they aren't as good as DeAndre Hopkins. So Hopkins comes in and will be the number one. He will demand the most targets. He will get the most targets. And that really caps the upside case for Treylon Burks. But there is the talent aspect as well, where, you know, both of those players showed flashes. And we've seen plenty of players be good for fantasy as a wide receiver, too. This is just unfortunate because it's a running offense that you don't expect to throw a ton.
I would feel better about that situation if several bullet points were fulfilled. One, they threw the ball more. They threw the ball the third least of any team in football last year. They threw the ball literally 20 times less per game than Tampa did, who was number one. That's a concern. Number two, if he'd done it before, if we had seen a big touchdown season from Treylon Burks or a longer sample size, that would give me more confidence. It would be looking at it more like a, well, maybe he can be a T. Higgins or he can be one of those complimentary guys. But it concerns me in an offense where you know it's Derrick Henry, you know it's play action pass, and you know that Hopkins is vastly superior to Treylon Burks. So when I look at both of those guys, and I'm the biggest Chigakonkwo fan in the world, I love the talent and the athleticism. I think I'm now the lowest in our rankings on him because both of those players, in my opinion, Treylon Burks, Chigakonkwo, if they do not score a touchdown, it is a bad week for fantasy for both of them. That's what I think the outcome is going to be. Whereas Hopkins, his volume will be more assured, but we don't have him super high. Jason's got him the highest at 21 right now.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, a wide receiver too. I have Treylon Burks also the highest, and that's only wide receiver 37. So obviously this isn't a huge upside case for really either of them with this offense. I think this is obviously very helpful for Ryan Tannehill and for the Titans. I mean, you guys, we already did that division, and you guys both picked the Titans to win the division. This has to be a massive help because there's questions. Can Treylon Burks be a wide receiver one for an NFL team? We haven't seen it yet. We think maybe he can. Well, he can be a wide receiver too. You know, it's one of those things when you bring a guy like Hopkins in, the rest of your depth chart, it looks really good now.
Yeah, I mean, one injury was the problem too. Like, if Burks went down, what do you have, right? If Hopkins goes down, now you have Burks. So there's upside in that respect because he's 31 years old. Hopkins is. He's been hurt, like, every season. So there is – I'm not saying don't draft Burks. It's just far from an assured outcome at this point. He was somebody that we were focusing on as a sleeper in the ultimate draft kit. And, you know, it is what it is. The team needed it. And it is good for Tannehill. You talk about two quarterback super flex leagues. Ryan Tannehill in a productive offense in a division that's winnable. Don't forget to look his way at the end of those drafts.
Totally agree.
And ironically, adding this wide receiver to a team, which is usually great for future dynasty quarterback prospects, I could see this being pretty bad for Bananarama. Just because if the Titans win and Ryan Tannehill has season.
Go ahead.
Will Levis, by the way.
Yeah, well, sure. I mean, we could call him by his given name.
He's being
Will Levis.
He's being beat out by Malik Willis right now.
I was going to say, I read that. Yeah. I don't know where the blurb came from. So I was going to ask if you guys had heard any of that.
I saw the same thing, that in camp right now, Malik Willis was outperforming.
I guess there was a USA Today blurb on July 9th that said Malik Willis is currently outplaying Will Levis, which,
and don't
holy
forget,
crap! If that's true,
Malik Willis could not outperform Joshua Dobbs last year. So
look, there's a chance that Willis has improved drastically as well, but this is yikes.
I think I'm the only person in the world that actually thinks Ryan Tannehill's like a good quarterback.
No, not at all.
He's good. It's just the efficiency and the numbers have gone down. I mean, he keeps winning football games.
He's very Joe Flacco at his best.
I think if you put Ryan Tannehill on the 49ers, he would be awesome.
Yeah, but Nick Mullins was pretty awesome on the 49ers, too.
Yeah, I'm just saying he would be better than the other guys they've had.
Completely agree. Are you a big Jimmy G fan?
Nope.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I agree with you. Tannehill can get the job done if the offense has the pieces. Last year they didn't. But, you know, Hopkins is going to help make them a winner.
It would be interesting for Hopkins. Like, he looked like he still had it last year. So that's the upside for Hopkins. As soon as he came back.
Give me the numbers, because it was 9 games last season for Hopkins, and he had almost 1,000 yards.
Yeah, I mean, his target share was out of control after what seemed like a down year before that. J.J. Zacharyson, this stat is credit to him. He said, since 2011, the only wideouts past their 10th year in the league to post a wide receiver 2 or better season: Larry Fitzgerald, Julian Edelman, Andre Johnson, Reggie Wayne, and Anquan Boldin. So, like, historically, Hopkins was already going to be up against it, staying with the Arizona Cardinals as, you know, in a more pass-friendly offense, at least it was with Cliff, and getting the huge target share. Now he goes to a lower pie, but the question will be, does he get back to the DeAndre Hopkins 30% target share? Because if he is there, he's fine. Like, he'll show up. He'll be a wide receiver too. If that comes down to like 26%, then that's where I kind of have him. I don't have him skyrocketing back up to being the only show in town. So he is an interesting pick, and I think a high risk with a decent amount of ceiling built in there, but a risky pick.
A 30% target share in that offense would be 7.8 targets a game.
So even from the numbers last year?
From the numbers last year. I mean, but that's been kind of their situation. Yeah. But, and that's not too exciting. And I have him at 28, Mike at 29. Definitely some better situations you could have gone to. Now, if you spent the offseason drafting Treylon Burks early in best ball, you're bummed out. But if you spent the offseason drafting Joe Mixon in best ball, you're excited because he agreed to a restructure.
Yep.
He's going to stay in Cincinnati. This is what it was trending this direction. We didn't see a path for this not to happen because they didn't have the requisite pieces that they would have needed to make it happen for him to depart. So,
but they still
they took a pay. He took a pay cut.
You need, like, when you're telling a guy, hey, we don't want to pay you this much money, they still have to come back and agree that they will pay, or they will play for less than you already told them you were going to play for. So it's a big deal, the restructure, because he'll be
was
there
leveraged.
Probably. I'm sure he was. He took a pretty substantial pay cut, about $4.6 million pay cut in 2024 as part of the new deal as well.
Yeah, that's what I was going to bring up. It's not just like, now we know he's playing this season. You can draft him confidently. I love this. You've had a great value on him. And honestly, he will be a good value come draft season, because the ADP has been so well established as a low ADP for him that it will, when we're at draft season, it's just going to be behind the times a little bit, and it'll be rising from now until then. But he'll be a good value.
Oh, I love him.
But next year, so in dynasty leagues, it seems like he will be playing for the Bengals for 2 years now with what he did financially.
And I know it was a down year for him from a yards per carry standpoint last season. Didn't score a ton of touchdowns. But the first 10 weeks before he got hurt last year, Joe Mixon was still on pace for 70 receptions. Samaje Perine is gone. We've talked about the trust that you got Chase Brown, right? And then you've got Travion Williams.
Mm-hmm.
So Joe Mixon is a guarantee for volume.
Yes, he is.
Another interesting piece of news. Evan Engram, right before the deadline, 3-year, $42.5 million contract.
We did it. We did it, everybody.
Congratulations,
and so,
Mike.
Thank
That's
you.
Pretty big for you.
I feel great about it.
Fourth round pick for you in that last draft.
Yeah, it was.
It's funny. I took Mixon in that draft. I took Engram for you in that draft. Both got good news. But Engram under contract. Mike's got him the highest at tight end 6. So there you go. He's been drafted at tight end 8. Plenty of upside. He had stretches last year that were weak winning performances. And then we don't know, but we do know, Josh Jacobs, Saquon Barkley, unlikely to get any sort of deal before the tag deadline hits at 1 p.m. today, which as of this moment, it's about 30 minutes away. So by the end of the show, we'll know definitively Josh Jacobs is likely to hold out at training camp. We've heard Saquon potentially have availability in week one against Dallas in question. At this point, hearing that from ESPN, is Saquon going to get a downgrade in your rankings?
He'll certainly get an upgrade in the risk rating because you need to know that there's a chance he could miss that game. Obviously, when you're at the place where Saquon's going and maybe you're looking at two great options, you're saying, okay, do I want Saquon or do I want Bijan or do I want Nick Chubb? Well, if you think there's a good, legitimate chance at that point when you're making a draft that Saquon's threatened to miss the opening week of the season, yeah, I would rather have the other guy. So it would move the needle.
Let me throw some more names out there to both of you, and you guys just let me know where the line is. Joe Mixon, aforementioned.
No,
or
Saquon. I would stick with Saquon.
I'd still go Barkley.
Jonathan Taylor.
I would stick with Saquon.
Just Taylor or Barkley? I'll go Barkley, yeah.
Breece Hall.
Saquon.
Yeah.
Najee.
Saquon.
Barkley, yeah.
Pollard.
I have Pollard ranked higher anyways. And Pollard is already – he signed his franchise, so, like, he's good to go. We would prefer for the man to get a long-term extension. Seems unlikely at this point, but he's already going to be playing.
One more for Jason because he has Saquon very highly ranked, and you're the lowest on Derrick Henry. Would this news change your Derrick Henry flip that?
I don't think so. I think I would keep Saquon there. I think on a per game basis, I would still take the one game absence and like Saquon a ton. The only guys, it's Bijan and Nick Chubb, Josh Jacobs. Those three guys, I think, it might flip the needle. And obviously, we got to wait and see what Jacobs does because maybe this is infectious and he's like, well, I'm going to miss week one if I'm not on a fridge.
Are these two guys going to go?
Oh, maybe like, they go fro-yo.
Yeah, like just go bro down, do some kind of, you know, running backs who are on the franchise tag vacation.
Yeah, they're going surfing.
Oh, surfing?
For sure. They're both huge surf dudes.
Are gigantic quads kind of a thing for surfing?
They can't hurt.
They squat down there, and you can't get them off that board.
Josh Jacobs is 25. Saquon's 26. Both of them won't have a birthday until after this season. And so you've got two really young players, very talented, still in their prime windows. And the franchise tag's $10.1 million for running backs. That's what Tony Pollard is going to play on. He's not missing camp. He's going to be there. But when you think about the investment that you have to make to lock up, like it probably costs you $12 million. Like Josh Jacobs would cost you $12 million a year for like 2 or 3 years to avoid this situation. And they're still, as of this moment, not doing it. But that's the perfect offseason script for Josh Jacobs. Last year, he was playing in the Hall of Fame game. So if you're playing in the Hall of Fame game, you could probably miss some camp and still be good. We'll find out. Maybe we'll get some breaking news.
Maybe.
Al Brooks, let us know. And then we had some minor injury news. Tyquan Thornton dealing with soft tissue issue. I want it to be said, Devontae Parker is a sleeper to me. Because you don't have Jacoby Myers, who is the tried and true option there. Parker has always been impressive on the big catches, the touchdowns. Thornton dealing with a soft tissue issue, and Hopkins didn't sign there, which is one of the things depressing his value. So I just don't want his name to be forgotten. I think that there's a decent chance, it's not guaranteed, that he's their best receiver this year, and that's got to be worth something in a draft.
Sure. I don't hate it.
I don't mind being out on there by myself.
No, you're like the Tyquan Thornton was already – up against it. He was a pretty highly drafted player. Kyle, was Thornton a second rounder?
Yeah.
Okay, he was a second rounder. But he, you know, historically you can look at players who have hit a threshold of like a yards per route run or target per route run that you have a pretty strong correlation or hit rate that these players have to hit this threshold, and then you see their career kind of blossom. Thornton did not.
His utilization was all gadgetry. It was all like a big play here or utilization in a screen. So I never saw him get out there and be like a alpha type of.
But I'm saying like that's part of the issue is if you come out here as a rookie and you're used that way, the team might be just telling the public, this is how we see this player. He can help us on the football field, but for fantasy football, the odds are really stacked against him.
All right, quick break, and we'll get into the divisional breakdown. Did you have anything to add there with Taquan, Jason? I know you've talked about him a little bit. Juju is in New England as well. But
I had some hopes for Thornton. I've got him a decent exposure rate on my best ball teams. I'm really sad to see the soft tissue issue for a guy that's a speedster, because those things can linger. You know, you remember he was a 4.28 player, and I think that the gadgetry that was, you know, the way he was used last year. You got Matt Patricia trying to run an offense. It's just not going into a year with Bill O'Brien. I was kind of hopeful that some of the athleticism and features that he has, you know, they could show up this year. But
yeah, he's a slender man.
Yes,
185, 6'2", but very fast.
Let's get divisional.
Well, I'm excited to talk about the AFC West today with you fine gentlemen.
I can't wait. Kansas City
Chiefs, defending champions.
Can't wait to shock you guys with my divisional pick at the end.
Oh, boy.
Stay tuned, everybody.
Yeah, nice tease.
Stay tuned.
Looking at offseason changes between 2022 and 2023, how these offenses could function, and then we'll predict. Who's going to win?
Stay tuned.
Kansas City last year was 14-3. The Chargers were 10-7. Raiders were 6-11. Broncos 5-12. And you know, this division is very, very interesting. It is littered with fantasy football options throughout. Starting with obviously the Chiefs, they have a 11.5 win total this year. It was 11 last year. So I mean, they are on the top of the mountain. Mahomes, Kelsey.
You could stop after Mahomes.
Really?
Like, oh, really?
Why do I have to stop after Mahomes? What? That's really disrespectful.
No. I'm saying they're on top of the world.
Oh.
They have Mahomes. That's good enough. You can do anything else on that roster, and they will be one of the best teams in the NFL. He's just a freak of nature.
Yeah, I mean, it was funny because you had made that comment about Aaron Rodgers and losing Devontae, and look what Mahomes did. But we do forget, or maybe didn't mention, like Kelsey is the linchpin of that offense.
Yes,
in a lot of ways.
He's the
so
one.
Does help. It does help him to have Travis Kelsey. But those are your two absolute fantasy stalwarts heading into the season. Andy Reid is the magic that unlocks the creativity, the goal line passing, which you love to see. I mean, if you are the running back room in that situation in Kansas City is very unpredictable. There's not going to be maybe as much of a, I guess, excitement around one specific guy in that backfield. But everybody's going to have Mahomes on those rosters and Kelsey. And the fact they throw the ball around the end zone so much that they're the highest scoring team in all of football, it just brings a lot of excitement. They got rid of Juju. I don't think any of us look at that and go, oh, Mahomes is in trouble. And then they brought in Richie James, who was very, very productive in New York last year. And they drafted Rashee Rice. So let's break it down a little bit. Mahomes set a record last year, 15 weeks as the quarterback one.
Yeah.
As a quarterback one, not the.
It's very tough because he's being drafted essentially at the beginning of the second round. I think it's too rich for me, for an ADP of, I think I can make up some ground at the quarterback position and bypass him there. Are you in on the early second round, or
it doesn't hurt you?
Okay, you're okay with it.
I'm not going to do it because I, like you said, you know, like if you're choosing Allen and Hurts, like if you like those three in the same category and Mahomes is going ahead of them, I'm not going to do it. But I genuinely think you aren't going to get burned by it. Like, I don't think your potential of being burned by drafting any of those three early is there. I really don't.
Yeah,
I mean, I don't think that there's an opportunity to be like last year. Herbert burned you, right? Is there a world where Burrow could burn you? Maybe.
Well, that's
I just don't think that Mahomes can burn you.
But the burn comes in the fact that those the big three of last year were so far ahead. Like the rest of the quarterback scoring was down so far, and you saw it. I mean, I think we highlighted some Warren Sharp stats about just offense in general was down. If that has a positive regression and more quarterbacks are and more offenses are healthy and functional, and those three guys aren't, you know, points and points and points ahead of the QB4, that's how you get burned. It's not that those three guys are going to be fantastic, but are they that much better? I think it's kind of the Jason's Travis Kelce argument too.
Right. No, it is actually very, very similar to that. And I think if I could meet you guys in the middle of what you're both saying, because I think you're both right, that getting Mahomes in the second round is not going to burn you. It's not going to crush your team and cripple it. But it's also not the optimal way to build a lineup should a Herbert, a Lamar Jackson, a Justin Fields, or even – worse, all three of them leap up into elite production this year, and now all of a sudden, well, there's rosters that they drafted one of those guys, and they got a second-round running back or a second-round wide receiver. So Patrick Mahomes, you could still win with him, obviously. He's Patrick freaking Mahomes, but your lineup wasn't built as optimally as someone who got someone in the fifth round that leveled up.
You're playing a different game, though, when you do that strategy. You're playing as scratchers. Because just because there was a gap last year between them and the other ones, and maybe that goes away. Well, who is it? You just named three names. What if it's one of the three? You've got to identify it. So that is the game that you're having to play later. Could you thread the needle and be perfectly right? Yeah, but with Mahomes, you will not have a bust. In fact, he threw 41 touchdowns last year. He could throw 50 because he's done it before. So like he can actually have an ascending year, not just a regression year. 50. Had the 26, missed three games, then 38, 37, 41. I just want to make the bull case for him. And sure. The fact that you don't have to do the gamble. Like, you put us through that mock draft the other day, and we didn't have to think about quarterback the rest of the draft. So that is an advantage sometimes, being able to focus on, you know, there's a lot of inputs in your draft. And if trying to figure out when you're going to get the one guy you might be taking the scratchers on, It can be an advantage, is my point. Because what if you're wrong? I mean, I waited on Herbert last year. That cost me. If I had spent it on Mahomes, I would have been better off.
Right, but Mahomes wasn't in the second round last year.
Well, Allen. If I had taken Allen in the second round, that would have worked out.
Sure.
Right?
Yeah.
Or if you, like you, identified Jalen Hurts late, then you did both. You got the double whammy, which is great, but you'd have to be able to get it right.
Yeah, and I guess that's the point, though, in the game we're playing is – I identified Jalen Hurts. I won a championship with him in our league of record. Only one team gets to win the championship. So you really want to be the team that plays the scratch. That's the way I see it. I feel like you're spending so much on Mahomes, and if he has a ceiling, you're going to be all right. You're definitely not going to be out of the running. You're going to be competitive, but it would be nicer to me to try to build. Like, I'm playing the scratcher. I'm going to try to grab Lamar two rounds later, or grab Herbert three rounds later this year and add the second round running back or wide receiver.
At the running back position, Isaiah Pacheco, Jerick McKinnon, Clyde Edwards-Helaire. I've been taking McKinnon myself late in drafts. He was the running back two in a five-week stretch end of the season.
He went crazy.
He's a wide receiver for them. Losing Juju, I think that we have to look at McKinnon as a weapon they're going to utilize in the offense. And you can just look to his production. I mean, Andy Reid's going to use a guy that scored 9 touchdowns in the receiving game.
Yeah, and it's 11th round. I have no problem with it. We've laid out the case of McKinnon's ascension. It lined up perfectly with Clyde Edwards-Helaire missing games. Not saying that they look at Clyde's production over his career as a Chief and say we got to for sure get him back in there. It could just end up being Pacheco and McKinnon. But for an 11th round pick for McKinnon, that's nothing. That's worth the risk.
I will point out that when both players were healthy, McKinnon had higher snap counts than Clyde Edwards-Helaire did. So he was still on the field around
in the beginning of the season?
In the whole beginning of the season. So he was on the field as much, if not more, than Clyde was when they were both healthy. But Pacheco emerged over the second half of the year.
I'd say for the beginning of the year, that's part of the issue. What could happen to McKinnon, though, is the I'm watching the Netflix show, the quarterback show.
Mm-hmm.
How is that, by the way?
I really like it. I love football. So, I mean, it's a lot of...
I'm seeing more positive than negative.
It's a lot of recapping of last year, but you're getting, you know, like more information. So I'm really, really enjoying it. But there was a play week one or two or something, and Mahomes misses a wide open McKinnon, who's on a wheel route, free touchdown, and he misses it. And they highlight it because Mahomes is just beating himself up for missing it. And then it's like the next play is a Clyde Edwards-Helaire receiving touchdown. So that's the issue, where Jerick McKinnon went on that tear over those final 4 weeks. You don't have that roulette option of, okay, the play didn't happen with McKinnon, and now Clyde's in on the play, so he doesn't get a chance
to do it.
Let
me put it this way. Are either of you drafting Pacheco at RB28?
Not me.
Mike?
It's not really an inspiring pick, but I'm okay with it. RB28 is...
Are you drafting Clyde in any league, way, shape, or form?
18th super, round of best balls.
Yeah, super deep.
Grabbed him.
Are you drafting McKinnon in the 11th?
Yeah, I'm fine with it.
I have not been.
Okay. Kadarius Toney, Marquez Valdez-Scantling, Sky Moore, Rashee Rice, Richie James, Justin Watson.
Oh, man.
It's crowded.
It's very crowded.
It's probably going to be at the end of the year where, hey, all these guys had a good game. Two of these guys had two good games. One of these guys had four good games, and it's probably not going to work out for fantasy as far as having someone emerge as a superstar. But this is one of those nebulous wide receiver rooms. You have Mahomes, so we've got to try to at least identify who could emerge, who could be special. You know, when I statted everything out for the Ultimate Draft Kit, my initial rankings were very high on Kadarius Toney. We've seen him be special. I've pulled back a little bit from that, but I remember seeing a quote just the other day from Mahomes talking up Kadarius Toney, and obviously you're going to talk up your own players, but he said, quote, he can be one of the best receivers in this league. Like, he really is loving Kadarius Toney. Now they've got an actual offseason with him. Remember, they brought Kadarius Toney in midseason. He was injured when they brought him over, so they couldn't even work him in. And they really never did work him in. They used him as a gadget player on a handful of plays every game. But there is a narrative to be built, at the very least, where with an offseason program, with Juju leaving, with Kadarius Toney having the opportunity to emerge as the wide receiver one for the team, he's got the talent to do it. And so if I wanted to put a bet on one of these players, that's where I would place my bet.
It's tough. MBS, would you say he was an important part of the offense last year in Kansas City? Yes or no?
Important to the offense?
Important to the NFL offense.
Yes.
See, I would say that too. And you can be important to Kansas City and end up outside the top 50 a wide receiver like he did. That's the challenge. But Kadarius Toney, I mean, it's amazing that Mahomes' top wide receiver option is being drafted as the wide receiver 40. So it's Travis Kelce.
Yeah.
Travis Kelce is the one and the two in the offense, and then they have 16 wide receiver threes right now. Led NFL in red zone targets. That includes wide receivers and touchdowns. That's what's so beautiful about Kelce, is that it's like you're around the goal line and you expect him mm-hmm. to be the one that scores.
They just,
as does the defense, and it makes no difference.
Andy Reid is too creative. I really want like the NFL to split up. Like, it's still a passing touchdown. That's fine. But I want to see how many shovel passes and tap passes. Like, what percentage of Mahomes' touchdowns are just these manufactured basic handoffs that just go forward to open up a lane for a touchdown?
There's, you know, in the show, again, that you're reminded of, there's – multiple Travis Kelce highlights of him. Yeah, he's getting the ball in space, and then he's just stiff arming defenders into oblivion. So
it's so fun when you have him on your team.
So it comes down to Travis Kelce is simply an ADP discussion. Right now he's slotted for the middle of the first, which is very, very expensive for a tight end or a onesie position.
I don't think any of us have taken him in any mocks.
I don't know that I've had the ability to. So I'm more on the side of, if I'm in the later half of the first round, I am 100% fine taking him. Because like
7, 8, 9?
Yeah. Like in that range, I am okay taking him. Because to me, Travis Kelce will still be the difference maker. If your strategy is Mark Andrews, then I'm okay with that because he's going multiple rounds later. But it's like, unlike where Mahomes and the discussion about the big three quarterbacks, I think some other quarterbacks can catch them and catch up and close that gap. I still have Mahomes and those guys on top, but some other quarterbacks are going to put up a fight. It's hard to see what other tight end in this current landscape could actually challenge Kelce or Mark Andrews.
152 targets.
And watching Kelce play last year, I mean, he was outrageously good. You know, 12 touchdowns compared to 9 the year before. More yards this past year than 2021. So it's not like we didn't see a weird dip in Travis Kelce's production and go, uh-oh, is Travis Kelce at the end? I don't think so. I think we have, for sure, at least another season of Travis Kelce being dominant. And you can't catch up with those points where I can try to catch up with wide receivers and quarterbacks or wide receivers and running backs. It puts your team at a weird position if you start with him, but I'm okay with it in the second half of the first round.
Let me ask Jason if his philosophy is identical around the tight end threading of the needle, because it's obviously a lot easier to identify a late Jalen Hurts, a late Josh Allen from years ago, a late Lamar from years ago, Kyler. Finding a quarterback seems like a lot of it's much more of an exact science.
Yes.
Than it is, you know, it's David Njoku this year. That's going to be a top two tight end. Like,
yeah, no, I don't do the threading of the needle at the tight end position because there aren't options. There's one.
Do the drafting of the Andrews instead of Kelce.
There's one needle threader that I grab around the 6-7 turn. So I get Mark
Waller
Andrews in the third.
Okay.
And if I can't get Mark Andrews, I am trying to thread the needle with a 6-7 turn Kyle Pitts. I'm taking that chance. And then after that, I just don't care. I'm going to grab I don't give me Higbee. I don't care.
You're just punting.
Yes, I'm punting the position at that point.
Okay. Yeah, that's good to know. All right, looking at the Los Angeles Chargers. Last year they were projected for 10 wins. That's where they ended, 10-7. This year is 9.5. They went 1-5 against teams with winning records last year. I feel like every bit of excitement that we had going into the season was metaphorically and maybe literally hit by a Mack truck, in the sense that injuries plagued this team. You had a quarterback in Justin Herbert that was playing injured throughout the season. You had long, long stints of Keenan Allen and Mike Williams missing time. Jalen Guyton went out before the season. Joshua Palmer didn't, you know, there's a lot on his shoulders to expect him to come out and carry the load, and didn't quite deliver. Still a team that played very fast, still a team that had a ton of passing attempts. But overall, last year, if you drafted any of those guys, it was a bust. Herbert, Keenan, Mike Williams. I mean, other than maybe Gerald Everett, I think it's a full bust.
Maybe. I would say if you were able to tread water and hold on to Keenan Allen, because the second half was not just like, oh, Keenan Allen, it was pretty good. It's no, Keenan Allen was great.
He was the wide receiver from week 11 on.
Thank you. So it's to a busted draft pick. It probably feels like it for most people, because I imagine they moved
guy,
on.
If you don't have your guy till week 11,
yeah,
that's a busted draft pick, because you don't get him in 18. That's really tough.
I feel like most leagues that I was in, the person that drafted Keenan Allen
didn't finish.
Get Keenan Allen's greatness.
So they draft Quentin Johnston to add another wide receiver to the room. It's exciting for Justin Herbert, even if you don't necessarily believe in Quentin Johnston as a potential sleeper this year. I don't know if you guys stand in that camp.
I do take some shots on Quentin Johnston. He's got the talent. He's got the yards after catch ability. And he's in an offense with an offensive coordinator and a quarterback that can get the job done. He's an unknown rookie with high draft capital. There's a lot of reasons to take the shot on him, and he doesn't cost much. You know, he's the wide receiver 42 off the board. So when I'm in that range, I'm looking for someone that could come out and kind of surprise us. My pre-NFL draft outlook on him wasn't the best. I didn't see him as a dominator.
I feel like all three of us are like, what are you doing with Quentin Johnston? I'm like, I don't know. What are you doing with Quentin? We're all like,
you don't know why?
I guess he's too pre-draft.
The reason why is that, one, and we haven't even mentioned his name this offseason, but Joshua Palmer plays for the Chargers. He's a very competent wide receiver 3. So we don't even mention. So the room is getting more, you know, it's busier than it used to be. Quentin Johnston, is a bet on an injury, and we don't like doing it. And that's why we're like, what are you doing with him? Because are you betting on Mike Williams or Keenan Allen to get hurt? Because if they don't get hurt, Quentin Johnson's probably not having some huge breakout season, is he?
Probably not. Yeah, probably not.
Because if that's the case, then you're saying either A, he's outperforming those other two, which I assume is that a possibility to you?
That's a possibility.
Mike Williams and Keenan?
Yeah, I mean, he'll
just be a secret weapon.
He projects more to be the Mike Williams type of role. Mike Williams is, you know, obviously older, and I don't necessarily think he's going to outproduce them. I don't have him statted that way if they're all healthy. Obviously, Mike Williams is never always healthy. He misses a handful of games all the time. But it's just one of those things where you go, okay,
like Julio to the Roddy of days of old?
With Herbert can throw 45 touchdowns. Like that is one of the range of outcomes with Kellen Moore and with health. You know, last year, Herbert was a major disappointment for fantasy drafters. But he lost Mike Williams a bunch. He lost Keenan Allen for half the year. He broke his ribs and played through it when he could barely move for several of those weeks. There were a lot of things that went very poorly for Justin Herbert, and they won 10 games. So, you know, if Justin Herbert has his weapons, has a more creative offensive mind to open things up and make them easier, adds a first-round rookie weapon, this is an offense that I think if you end up the year with, like, 45 touchdowns, then they all three had good seasons.
Kellen Moore's teams, Dallas, obviously, number one and number four in points scored the last 2 years.
Too many.
Too many points for...
It's too many for old McCarthy. How dare you?
Number one and number four and you get canned, huh?
I think it was a mutual... I don't know that... Was
mutual
it a
party.
Firing? It just seemed like, yeah, he wants to move on because he heard he could get Herbert.
Yeah, I don't... I mean, it's... There's a lot to be excited about. But they're in a division that you see them as is not the best team in the division.
Well, we don't know yet.
Yeah,
stay tuned.
Hey, whoa. Got to keep the listeners the whole show.
They have a good O-line. They lost Rashawn Slater for 14 games last year. That hurt. I remember when that happened and Herbert was beat up and it was like, there's no hope any of these weeks throwing the ball to Josh Palmer and no one else. So Herbert has a tremendous upside case. Yeah. I have him a QB5 right now. I guess that's the highest. I don't know where you guys have him. But
we're all in on Herbert this year.
Eckler was the RB2 last year. He has 36 red zone touchdowns the last 2 years. He's been targeted on 27% of his routes. He is a tried and true weapon.
And he's playing for a contract on a contract year. You know he's out there.
And he's feeling pretty spicy.
Yeah.
I mean, he is like the quote was him saying, you know, when I look out there and there's backup wide receivers making more money than me, like, he is...
That's not fair.
I totally agree. But he is rightfully upset.
Yeah, the running back salary situation is not... I don't think it's not fair.
You didn't bring this up.
I just think... no deal, by the way, for Josh Jacobs.
Yeah, you didn't bring it up earlier. But if you look at the franchise tag values from 2015... The cost of the franchise tag to put it on a quarterback has gone through the roof. It's just, you know, obviously salaries always go up.
Everything has gone up.
Wide receivers through the roof. It's cheaper today to franchise a running back than it was in 2015 because the franchise tag is based on the top five paid players
something
at the
like
position
that.
Or something like that.
And they've gone down.
And nobody pays running backs.
Yeah, because it's a bad bet.
Yeah,
it's not good for the team. It's like none of us want our teams to go pay their running backs.
Right.
Right? We say that we want our fantasy players to have contracts.
I got a quote here, guys.
Hold on. Hold on.
Can we play a game?
Breaking news.
All right. I want you to tell me if this seems like positive sentiment or negative. Okay?
Okay. I'm listening.
This is direct from
you
the
source.
You
haven't seen this yet, Jay?
I haven't seen.
Oh, perfect.
Okay. This is direct from
You're
the source.
You're playing with Jason.
Okay? This is from Saquon Barkley, superstar running back, New York Giants. He has recently tweeted, "It is what it is."
Okay. All right.
Now, you tell me.
Yeah.
Is this positive or is this negative?
This is negative. This is not a happy man. This is throwing my hands up.
Has anyone ever said it? Like, I love
in a good way.
I love phrases like this. Like, everything is everything, or it is what it is. But has anyone ever used that? Because like, things were going great.
Oh, right. Like, just everything's going well. Like, yeah, it is, like, what it is. Yeah.
How did you win those millions of dollars? I don't know, man. It is what it is.
No.
Saquon and Jacobs will both be, if they play, which I assume they will play at some point, it's going to be contract year story for them, just like it is for Eckler at the running back position. Jacobs did that last year. He was playing for a contract last year.
Right.
Then he gets franchised because he played so well.
Also, this is incredible. Kyle just dug this up. According to the New York Times, the phrase, it is what it is, appeared as early as a 1949 article by J.E. Lawrence in the Nebraska State Journal. Lawrence used the phrase when describing the difficulty faced during frontier era life in Nebraska.
Oh, man. Frontier life in Nebraska.
It is what it is.
No, that's what it's like being a running back.
Yeah, it
is. It's like being on the frontier in Nebraska.
Oh, man.
But for what it's... for what it's worth, they will both make $10 million this year.
Yeah, which I don't get caught up in that. It's just,
no, I know.
It's comparing it to your peers and
of
what
course.
You bring. And hey,
it's not easy being a running back.
No,
it's not.
And
they should make a new rule. If you want to fix this, I got your fix. You're not allowed to draft running backs except for every other year. Something like that. Because right
you
now
you can't replace them with
the market's
cheap labor.
Just, you know, neither player signed their tender, so we'll keep you up to date with that. Eckler.
Well, they're not going to sign until they want to show up.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's the point, is we'll figure out whether they participate in some of camp or not. If, you know, they just decide, hey, let's show up and start collecting checks and let's move on towards getting a contract next year. That's where we're at.
Yeah. Maybe they'll hold in.
All right. So, yeah, let's. What is this? More news, Brooks? What's going on?
Just confirmation.
All right, neither player reached a deal. All right, so Eckler, he's been dominant for the last 2 years, playing on a contract year. Unless you want to sit here and make the same argument that's been made against him for 3 years about him scoring too much compared to averages, you know, he's going to be a dominant force. I mean, he's ranked at the RB2 for a reason.
He'll be a great fantasy option. I don't think he finishes, like, I've got him as running back 2. I don't think he finishes there. I would still draft him as the second one because I think you're on a great offense. The depth chart is disgusting around you, and you're the main show. You catch a ton of passes. But it's not just touchdown regression. When he was on the field with both Mike Williams and Keenan Allen, his target market share was... it was like
was
almost
like 45 minutes last year.
It wasn't much, but it was almost like half of what it was in the games where it was just one of them. And now they add Quentin Johnson.
It's
stuff.
So yeah. Sorry.
So target coming down a little bit, touchdowns maybe regressing, but you're still the dude on a great offense.
It's just so easy. If you catch 107 passes, it's very easy to be top five.
Yeah, it's hard to not be top five.
Yeah, and he caught 107 passes, so touchdowns thrown out the window. If you catch 100 plus balls, you're going to end up top five.
I have him ranked a bit lower than you guys do, and it's for me, it's the combination of, you know, being overly efficient forever, but also he's 28 now, and it's, you know, the age cliff for running backs, it's right around 27, 28. So I see him coming down just a bit.
Let's talk Raiders. They're 6-11. Or they were 6-11. They went into last year with an 8.5 win total. They said it wasn't McDaniel's fault. It was Derek Carr's fault. Let's get rid of him. this year, they're projected for fewer wins, 7.5. They led by double digits at halftime in 5 games. Mm-hmm. They went 1-4 in those games. They went 1-6 when they had Waller and Renfro, so you can't blame injuries. And Josh McDaniels looked terrible as a head coach again. Let's just be honest. The best decision he made as a head coach was to take the Hall of Fame game running back Josh Jacobs and give him the ball 10 million times. I mean, Jacobs, if he is the starter, which he should be, if he's playing in week one, you know, he had the 5th most rushing yards over the last decade. He caught a ton of passes. It is very similar to what you just talked about with the depth chart in Los Angeles. Like, this was a player 8-7-1-3-8, a stretcher in the middle of the year where he was, I mean, he had three number one overall finishes last year for a guy that only Brooks believed in. So if he plays, what's his ceiling? Probably where he was last year, right?
Yeah, I don't think he is going to possibly be able to repeat the ceiling he hit last year from a production standpoint, because the offense will be worse this year, I think, with the change at quarterback. I don't project this team to be better. Obviously, they lost Darren Waller. It's a tough division, but the depth chart around him is such that you project an absolute massive workload. He's on the franchise tag.
Not worried
too.
About Brandon Bolden?
No, I'm not
Amir
worried
Abdullah?
About any
the Abdullah
of them.
Express?
So you're talking
he
about.
He catches some passes.
He will touch the ball 350 times. and if you touch the ball 350 times, you're going to be great. Your floor is so extremely high. Now, whether or not he's able to get the touchdowns and the big plays that he had last year, that's probably not going to happen at the same clip. So I see him as a really, really safe option that's probably going to finish the year as lower end RB1.
Yeah, I mean, I look at him the same as Nick Chubb. You know, he's going in the back of the first round. To be that efficient on that many touches shows a level of skill that you saw in the field. But repeating it every year is going to be difficult. Those two players have a hard time. Like right now I have it Chubb, Jacobs, 3-4. I want both of them very badly on my team. Davante Adams, ho-hum, did it again. Is he undervalued at wide receiver 8? Should he be in these discussions or are you just so afraid of the quarterback situation?
It's funny because it's like the same situation as last year. He's a little older. He's switching quarterbacks, major downgrade at quarterback. And then I didn't bet on Davante Adams. I was like, yeah, I'm going to let other people do that. And then it was, I should have bet on Davante Adams. He's so good. And now it's like, he's a year older and he's getting a bad quarterback again.
That's been the lesson the last few years. Oh, Tyreek Hill's got two. It doesn't matter. You know, yeah, Davante Adams is Derek Carr. It doesn't matter.
We still haven't ranked very high. But I would say the cautionary flags for him are going from – so you got Derek Carr to Jimmy Garoppolo. Derek Carr is – he doesn't do it a lot, but he's actually like a pretty capable deep ball passer. And we saw like an A-dot and a yards per completion here from Davante Adams that he hasn't seen. Let me double check. Ever. He averaged 15.2 yards per completion. His second highest in that category would have been year three in the league at 13.3. They used Adams a completely different way. And now, what does that look like for Jimmy Garoppolo, who is nearly allergic to throwing the ball down the field? Like, he's very scared to do it. So if we take that back, do we still get, you know, the that level of production where Davante Adams is the wide receiver 3 on the season? And on top of that, you had games where Davante Adams just basically vanished from production, including a 3-week stretch from weeks 14 through 16 that was pretty devastating. So Davante Adams is still fantastic, but he's not in that group up there for me that with Hill, Jefferson, Kupp, and Jamar.
I don't know if I'll have success, but I know he'll be vocal enough to get the targets.
Yeah, probably.
I mean, that part is guaranteed. And if you're being drafted in the middle of the second round,
I thought, yeah, that's
it. It could work out for you. He is getting older. They added Jacoby Myers this offseason. They added DeAndre Carter. They added Austin Hooper and O.J. Howard.
Yeah, that's the – so they drafted – what?
Darren Waller not sucking up targets the way that he used to, so maybe Jacoby Myers and Hunter Renfrow can both.
This is a Davante Adams, Josh Jacobs checkout situation for me. It's not against Jacoby Myers. He's a good football player. But Hunter Renfrow's still there, and all the targets are going to be going to Davante Adams first, and then you're just taking a middling to bad offense and saying, let's split up the leftovers between Hunter Renfrow and Jacoby Myers and Austin Hooper. It's like, yeah. I don't want any of that. Just move on.
It is weird. Like, I think we all remember the very nice end of season to 2021 for Hunter Renfrow. But, man, last year was 100% a shot year.
Yes.
Like, if you talk about you're with McDaniels, and then you come out and you're just meaningless for the first 9 weeks of the year, I wonder if they're kind of done with him. What's his contract situation?
let's see.
I know he missed time with injury. I don't want to
drafted in 2019, so this
is the final year.
I would think so, yeah.
I wonder if that's part of the thought process here with the Myers signing. Is if Renfro's just on the way out. I don't know.
Well, and you need another player.
Has to go to Denver and Buffalo in the first 2 weeks. So if you want to check out after those two guys, because you got to go play in Denver and Buffalo and then Pittsburgh and the Chargers, tough start to the year for this
two
team.
Years. Oh, did he sign an extension?
Oh, he did. He did sign an extension.
Yeah, good for him. Let me just check real quick.
Throw out everything I said.
Michael, I always forget, Meyer or Mayer? Which one? Meyer? I think it's Meyer.
I think it's Meyer.
I think it is, too. But now it's that weird thing where you're second-guessing yourself.
Michael Mayer?
Is it Mayer?
Yeah, it's Mayer.
Oh,
yeah, I think it's Mayer. Yeah.
Hold on. Michael Mayer?
Mayer?
No, it's Mayer.
Okay.
Mayor.
That's why I was
you
asking.
You guys kept making Michael Myers jokes.
Oh, that's what did it.
Yeah, we screwed ourselves up.
Yeah, this is on you.
That's not on us. There's a character named Michael Myers.
But so Michael Mayer, the tight end that they drafted pretty high. Do you guys have any interest? Because I see people on Twitter talking about him frequently, and I'm like, I don't get it at all. They brought Austin Hooper in on a 1 year. You brought O.J. Howard in, and Josh McDaniels, one of the lowest rates of two tight end sets in the league.
Blah.
So
I get
blah.
It.
Blah.
Michael Mayer. Is awesome. I know
Meyer.
Thank you. I know that a lot of people disagree with that. I don't even understand how you would think he's not great. He was a 5-star recruit. He dominated every year. He's a baby boy.
I think if there were certain teams on the clock, he would have gone ahead of Dalton Kincaid.
Absolutely. I mean, to me, he's great. I'm completely out for fantasy and redraft. Okay. Like, there's no freaking chance I'm
Jason
drafting
Moore,
a rookie
tight end. Come
tight
on.
End in
Come
this
on.
Situation. And not happening.
When I get mayhem. You're getting a rookie tight end.
No.
Dalton Kincaid.
Don't you give me Dalton Kincaid.
Lock Dalton Kincaid in there. All right, so we're going to move on. Let's talk about the Denver Broncos. Last year was a disaster. Russell Wilson was the most bet player preseason for the MVP award.
Dude, look at that.
They won four games. No, they were 4-9 in one-score games. They won five games.
In their 2022 Vegas projected win total was 10.
Wow.
Adding Russell Wilson made them score the least amount of points of any football team in the game. 32nd in points per game.
How?
I am not going to bet on Sean Payton fixing the calamity that we witnessed last year. I just don't. I mean, maybe he does. I hope he does. It's good for football. It's good for fantasy. But my personal bet is against a rebound for Russell Wilson. And so I find, a lot of people are really into Jerry Jeudy this year. He's going to separate, and be the one. If it's any kind of draft capital, I'm just
wide out. Receiver 25, back of the fifth.
Yeah, I'm not doing that personally.
Unlimited.
I believe that we watched a bad quarterback play poorly, and I don't think he's just going to snap out of it.
It's a tough bet. And if they succeed as a team, you may see that 16th ranked pass attempts go to Titans range, and you start using Javonte and P. Ryan in this defense, which is very good. That's their pathway.
So bad for their defense. Their defense was so dominant last year. The first half of the year, they just shut everyone down, and they still lost games.
Yeah, so through 10 weeks, to your point, Jason, the defense held every opponent under their implied team total, allowing 16.6 points per game, which is number one in the NFL, and they went 3-6. So I don't know how that doesn't – like, walking in that locker room, I know Russell Wilson, he may be immune to the feeling in the air, but that –
the other players aren't.
I mean, they knew where the turd was.
Yeah. It was in front of Russell Wilson's locker.
I don't feel bad for him at all. When you're paid that kind of money, you force your way out of a situation. You have a responsibility under that amount to lead and to succeed and to be held accountable if you don't and to get all the praise if you win. That's what a quarterback does. They get all the praise. Most bet MVP candidate. Why? Because if he goes in there and they win a bunch of games, it's his fault. So if you lose a bunch of games, it's your fault too. I do see a pathway to some relevance. It was a better end of the year. Jerry Jeudy is a very good player. Tim Patrick coming back, drafting Marvin Mims. Greg Dulcich is an emerging wide receiver talent. If you are taking a shot outside of, do we all have Jeudy the highest at the wide receiver position?
I do.
Okay. So I'm going to say we got him a wide receiver 25. We're all ahead of ADP on that, believe it or not.
No. We have
19 by consensus. 25 is ADP.
Yeah.
Outside of Jeudy, cast your lot with a Bronco pass catcher.
There's two that I'm willing to draft, and it's Tim Patrick and Greg Dulcich. And the reason is because they cost nothing. I'm taking a super late shot that it gets fixed, and I don't have to invest anything.
That's fair. Made $129 million over the last 3 years, more than any other player in football. Russell Wilson.
Super.
They added Callaway to the offense as well. P. Ryan. They lost Mike Boone. But that's not making headlines. So, yep. Cortland Sutton.
Man.
It's weird to have a guy that you know is going to be lining up as a starter every play that you still don't really want to even glance in their direction.
Well, yeah. What's insane is...
because it's been Cortland Nutton.
Last year, Cortland Sutton was drafted ahead of Jerry Jeudy. And it wasn't like last year went great for either player. But now this year, situations haven't really changed. And
Jeudy showed something at the end of the year.
And Sutton is four rounds behind Jeudy. And I think pretty much everyone's just saying, no, I'm done with Sutton. No, I'm not playing that game.
Yeah, it's... Those
last 5 weeks helped Jeudy a lot.
Yeah, it was a pretty good run.
During that stretch, he was on pace for 112 catches, 1,557 yards, and 10 touchdowns.
Yep. That would be why Judy's in front.
But and you know, I know you want good things for Jerry Jeudy, Jason.
I loved Jerry
Jeudy.
He used
to watch so many highlight videos that he'd be late to lunch.
Mm-hmm. And I am never late to eat.
Only for Jerry.
Greg Dulcich, is he one of those guys in that category of when you punt, you go?
Yep.
Do you have him ahead of a guy like Chigakonkwo after the Hopkins news?
Yeah, I've got Greg Dulcich a little bit ahead. You know, it's Gerald Everett is one of my late round, kind of last round tight end picks.
I'm kind of moved off of him. We didn't talk about tight end in Los Angeles, but just because of Parham's health and the discussions around him, I'm afraid.
Sure.
But Gerald Everett's always been doubted.
Yeah, Gerald Everett's
kind of accidentally productive.
Gerald Everett will be on the field ahead of Parham, so that's why I bet that way.
Give me your thoughts on Javonte Perine right now. Javonte is being drafted significantly higher. You know, all the talk is he'll be back and ready.
Yeah, it was a catastrophic knee injury. It was not a simple ACL injury. And I know they're saying the team is saying all the right things, but you can book that. That's what they do. Guys get injured, and then over the off season, they're ahead of schedule. They look great. They're doing all this, doing all that, and then it comes time to play football, and shocker, the person with the devastating knee injury is not ready to play in the NFL. So I'm hopeful for the man that he's ready, but as of right now, I would project that Javonte Williams is going to miss at least a handful of games and then not be ready to be the full-time starter, which has me drafting Perine as a as a Band-Aid for my running back position over the first month.
Jason?
Yeah, I'm pretty similar. I'm mostly right now just out. I recognize that there could be gold in them hills for either player, but it's one of those situations where I don't know the health of the knee, and whatever fluff pieces are coming out is something I will not be listening to. I'm going to watch what is actually happening on the field to make my decisions closer to the game. So right now, like in best ball, I'm pretty much just avoiding the situation, not trying to pretend that I have secret inside information, because it's just health. If Javonte is actually healthy, well, man, he's a steal. I don't think he's going to be actually healthy, in which case, if he misses time, Samaje is a steal. Or does he just get there week one and he's not that good yet and he doesn't produce and Samaje's not on the field? I'm taking a wait and see approach.
Yeah, I think the one thing you could probably bet on more safely of whether he shows up or not is just there's a reality where both guys get a lot of work all year long.
Sure.
I mean, that
yeah, they Sean paid, Payton's system.
They paid P. Ryan to come in and play. I mean, this is a hand-picked by Sean Payton, and he's a capable third-down guy. They could both just – they could alternate drives the whole year long.
Payton's running back room has always been very, very valuable for fantasy. So if you want to take your shots, it's logical. And this isn't just Alvin Kamara. This is before Kamara. This is Deuce McAllister and
Timmy Hightower, Jason.
Anybody and everybody. When they're back there, he knows how to set them up for success.
Well, this might the suspense is over. Let's order this.
Oh man,
let's order this division.
All right,
I'm going to go Chiefs.
What?
I know, shocker. Chargers.
Okay.
Broncos. Raiders.
Okay.
Raiders are on the 2-year goodbye to McDaniels. Get themselves a rookie quarterback plan.
Does he make it through the year?
Probably not. Because that's scheduled to start the year. He'll be a nice 0-4 to kick it off, and then desperation. Jimmy G will cause some drama. No, this Raiders are the biggest. They could hurt our Cardinals' number 1 and 2 picks.
I'm going. It's so tough at the top. I'm going to go Kansas City, though.
Whoa.
Okay.
Yeah. Then I'm going the Chargers.
Okay.
Broncos.
Oh, all right.
Raiders. Gotcha. So we are in sync.
All right.
All right. I really hope everyone stay tuned. Because I'm going to win this division. The Chiefs of Kansas City.
What? All three of us?
Yes. Second place, I will give it to the Chargers of Los Angeles. I'm going to go with the Denver Broncos in third.
Oh.
Why aren't they the Broncos of Denver? You're really letting me down based on the first two.
Thank you, Andrew.
Because it's Denver. It's different.
Okay.
And then I will go with the Raiders of Las Vegas in fourth place.
What in the world is wrong? All right, that is the end of the show.
I told people to stay around. I had to give them something special.
Go to ballerslive.com and come see us. The Megala Show live in L.A. end of August. Get your tickets now at ballerslive.com. Talk to you soon.
Goodbye.
Thank you for listening to another episode of the Fantasy Footballers Podcast. Join our fantasy football community on jointhefoot.com and follow us on Twitter @TheFFBallers.